Who gets the first question?
Sure. Yeah. Yes, I said earlier, I was on the coalition that won marriage equality in New York State, working with Governor Cuomo, Danny O'Donnell, a number of other elected officials, as well as marriage equality and other organizations. I've been endorsed by a number of elected officials, including Ejonas Rodriguez. Ejonas Rodriguez is a council member. He is the only council member who's endorsed in this race. I have worked closely with other council members who are friends of mine, who have been clients of mine as a civil rights attorney. All of this indicates that I would be able to work very closely and collegially with the body in city council. And I will continue to be somebody who stands up for our community to do that. I actually see a community-based coalition building and collaborative efforts as very positive and something that I can bring to those collegial relationships in city council to problem solve and to really deliver for our community with my community.
I think it's an incredibly important question. So much of being able to deliver in a 51-member body, and that's the size of the city council, is being able to work with your colleagues, work with other local elected officials, work with the community, work with community boards, work with community organizations, work with PTAs, work with tenant associations. I have done that for 8.5 years on Manhattan Community Board. And the reason why I've never worked for an elected official, I don't come out of a Democratic club. The reason why Jerry Nadler and Deborah Glick and Tom Duane and so many others are supporting me, as I said at the beginning, is not because I think they think I'm a nice guy, but because they've actually seen my work. They've seen me work with PTAs on getting more funding in schools. They've seen me work with local folks to get more affordable housing. They've seen me fight for more parks and open space. They've seen me do that work for 8.5 years. I have already done it, and I will continue to do that on the council. And I think, you know, you said at the beginning, Yetta, that you don't want someone as part of the, forgetting the word, political
special class. Interest.
No, that's not the one you said.
Real estate interest.
Political class.
Political insiders.
Political insiders. I don't think people consider who considers Jerry Nadler a political insider? People consider him a progressive elected official who has fought for us in Washington.
Yes.
And Yetta, let's be clear. You sought out all these endorsements. You met with them and asked them to support you.
And you lost.
And so you asked for their support. You asked for their support. They didn't support you, and now you rail against them as political insiders. It's disingenuous.
First of all, I have been endorsed by a number of elected officials. I've been endorsed by former Mayor David Dinkins, by Betsy Gottbaum, by Tony Ferrer, Ejonas Rodriguez, Senator Eric Adams, and the list goes on. But here's the issue. The issue is none of these elected officials, who we all both respect, are going to come with us to City Hall. It's going to be us who's going to be your voice in City Council. So the real question here that you're going to be tasked with when you go to the polls, is it your job as members of this community to elect the person who the political insiders and the special interests are going to feel most comfortable working with? Or is it your job to elect the person that you know will be your voice, even when the chips are down and the special interests are lined up against you behind closed doors, and you need to know who's going to stand up for you? In your heart of all hearts, who do you think has the commitment, the compassion, the courage, and the record to stand up for you?
I am deeply honored to have the support of all of our good, local, hardworking elected officials. I don't think people consider them, a lot of people don't consider them political insiders, and you sought their endorsement. Not a single local elected official has endorsed you, and I think that says something. And also, the endorsements that I'm most proud of are the ones from local PTA presidents, local block associations, local tenant association presidents. George Kaminsky, the president of the West Bethel Residents Council, is supporting me. Morris Benjamin, the president of the co-op at Penn South, is supporting me. Woo. Tom Gautieri, the tenant association president at Manhattan Plaza, is supporting me. Woo. They're supporting me because they've seen the work that I can do in the community. Juan Brea and Catherine Crosby, the co-presidents of the PTA at PS 11, are supporting me. Nick Gottlieb, the PTA president at PS 3 in the Village, is supporting me. So these people are not political insiders. Yeah. They are local folks who live and work and raise their children in the community. And they are supporting me because they have seen the work that I have done. They have seen me work with people to actually achieve things. So stop distorting who I am. Let's have an honest discussion based on the issues. And let's stop using these generalized terms to paint people a certain way. I haven't done it to you.
Corey, you're imagining something. You're imagining something that doesn't exist. I've never called Nick Gottlieb a political insider. What I am saying is that the beautiful thing about democracy is that a community gets to decide who should represent them. And when people go to the polls, what they have to ask themselves, you talk about a record of 8 years sitting on the community board, you talk about affordable housing that you've won. Let's talk about that affordable housing. I don't know if that's going to be an additional question specifically.
Well, maybe, but let's, you'll have to say that, Corey.
So again, when you listen to Corey talk about being a fighter for affordable housing, he talks a good game, right? But what he's talking about is Mayor Bloomberg's plan. It's the new market plan for housing, okay? And when you think it absolutely is. And what that plan says is that 20,000 units will be built in this district. 20,000 units, the overwhelming majority of which are going to be luxury apartments. Only 5,000 of those units are supposed to be affordable housing. Now, as I said before, under Corey Johnson's tenure as chair, every single one of those upzoning applications have been approved by Community 4.
Out of
the 5,000 units that were supposed to be built, only 16% of those units have actually been built. And then when you look at those units that have been built, the overwhelming majority of them are not affordable. Is that the type of affordable housing that you want?
No.
Okay. As a tenants' rights attorney, I have fought genuinely to protect affordable housing. I've represented individuals like Penny down the street from me, who had a landlord who was trying to evict her and others so that they could turn her building into more luxury condominiums. I stood up for her in court. She's still living in a rent-stabilized apartment. I've represented folks who are in rent control, rent-stabilized, and SRO apartments. I've helped to protect SROs and low-income housing in this city and in this district, and as the next city councilor. So what do we do about this?
Your time's up. We got to move on.
I'd love to talk about my plan.
We can go back to affordable housing later.
Before I get to the specifics of what you just talked about, and I don't have a clue what you're referring to, because I haven't talked about what you said. Hold on, let me finish, Yetta. I know where I come from, and I know who I am. I grew up in public housing. My mom was my lunch lady, my dad was a Pepsi truck driver, and I have never made a lot of money. I live in a 300-square-foot studio apartment on West 15th Street. If we want to have an open house after the debate tonight, we can, but we can only fit four people at a time in my apartment if you want to come see what a real estate executive's apartment looks like. So stop miscategorizing what I've done and who I am. Let me tell you what I have talked about. I have said that the prime example of what we should have of affordable housing in this district are places like West Beth, Penn South, and Manhattan Plaza. Places that are mixed income, affordable housing, low, moderate, and middle. And what the city should do, and I said this the other night in our debate, the city should stop relying upon the 421A program, a state program, which is the 80-20 program. Stop relying upon these state and federal programs. The city should invest public dollars in building real affordable housing, like Penn South, like West, like Manhattan Plaza. That is what we should do on affordable housing. And that is what I would advocate for in the city council.
Except that's not what happened in the community board, which approved the Hudson Yards. Also, you boasted, wait, if I may, you boasted about creating more affordable housing for artists, saying that you created 100 units of affordable housing for artists in Midtown, when in reality, you had taken those 100 units of Section 8 from Manhattan Plaza, transferred them to this
new
facility, and then reduced those numbers, so we actually are losing a sum total of 12 units of affordable housing, not winning any. We've lost more affordable housing in the last 10 years than we've ever lost. We lose on average 10,000 units of affordable housing in decontrol alone every single year. We are not moving forward, and we are massively upzoning this neighborhood, displacing middle and lower income New Yorkers under this administration.
Okay, Corey has the last word on this. We're going to move on after that.
Yet if there's one organization that endorses in the political process in New York City and New York State, and that is Tenants PAC. And Tenants PAC overwhelmingly endorsed my candidacy because they've seen the work that I have done on affordable housing in this district. I think that says something. When it comes to Manhattan Plaza, you are 100% wrong. That is not factually correct.
I'll send you the link to the article, Corey.
Okay, Corey's going to finish it.
The units at Manhattan Plaza that were transferred were Section 8 units that were no longer being used as Section 8. And what we did was we kept Section 8 units, which stayed affordable for people in the community. There were Mitchell Lama units that were at a higher income bracket at Manhattan Plaza. We created 139 new affordable housing units at 29th Street and 10th Avenue. Those are the facts. Ask the Manhattan Plaza Policy Committee. Ask Congressman Nadler's office. And you can call Secretary Donovan, the head of HUD, because he was involved with it. Those are the facts.